An atmospheric chemistry expert calls out various governments, including the Philippines, for their outdated COVID-19 protocols. Dr. Jose Jimenez of the University of Colorado in Boulder says plastic barriers and face shields are not the way to go to deal with an airborne virus. He now joins us for more on this. Good morning, Dr. Jose. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
All right. So first off, let's talk about your tweet concerning the Philippines' extensive use of lateral plexiglass barriers in schools and restaurants and how they actually increase transmission of the virus. Now, could you expound on this? And when are plexiglass actually useful?
Okay. So first of all, we have to understand that the virus is an airborne virus, and that's the only important mode of transmission. That means that when people talk, the virus leaves like cigarette smoke, and you get infected into situations. If you talk close to someone, you smell the garlic because you are inhaling, for example, the air that's leaving that person. You have more distance, you inhale less air. Now, if you are sharing a room, like smoke from a cigarette, it mixes in the room, and you can inhale a lot if you spend a lot of time in the same room. And that's when we see a lot of transmission, when people are close by, in close proximity, or when people share a room, which are all the super spreading events. Once we understand this, then what we want is ventilation. We want that virus to go out. And the barriers are useful for the first situation. If you have two people talking and the air from one of them would wanna reach the other, but you have a barrier, then the barrier is gonna stop that smoke, invisible smoke, and it's gonna go around. I mean, the person behind it is not protected. The smoke will make it through, but it's protected from the direct hit, right? So that's useful. But when they're lateral, then they block ventilation, then the air that has the virus gets trapped and it doesn't go outside. And that's when they are damaging. And there is a study in the US where they found schools that had those lateral barriers had double the transmission.
Mm-hmm. And Dr. Jose, jeepneys, a common public transport here in the Philippines, are also advised to have plastic barriers. What of face shields? Last year, we had a Filipino civil engineer, Joshua Agar, who had the same opinion, but this time concerning face shields also increasing the transmission of COVID. Do the same principles apply?
Yes, the face shields are outdated. At the beginning of the pandemic, we thought that when two people talk, it was some projectiles, these droplets that were flying through the air, and then a face shield could intercept them. Now we know that's not the case. It's like smoke, and the smoke can go under the face shield. So face shields basically are useless except in a hospital. If someone is gonna cough on your face, then it's useful. Mm-hmm. But really what we need in a place like a hospital, since there can be transmission through the eyes and the aerosols can get under the face shield, what's better to have is some closed glasses, like safety glasses that you may use in a laboratory or something like that. And face shields are not useful. We should invest the money instead on better masks and things that actually work.
And simply put, you called out our government for being stuck on droplets and not really understanding that COVID is airborne, leading to the enforcement of some very outdated protocols, as you have said. Even the WHO has actually admitted that COVID is airborne and no longer says that droplets are dominant. In layman's terms, could you explain to our viewers the simple difference between droplets versus aerosols?
Well, it's simple to explain. Let's say I'm infected. That means in my saliva or in my respiratory fluid, which is the liquid that wets my lungs, there is a virus. It needs to go through the air to another person. It can go in balls of saliva and respiratory fluid that have the virus. And there are two sizes, big and small. Big droplets, small aerosols. Big are projectiles, like little cannonballs. Either they hit you inside the eyes, inside the nostrils, inside the mouth, or nothing happens. They hit you here, nothing happens. They fall to the ground, nothing happens. Aerosol, like smoke, they float in the air. They infect you by breathing them in, or if they deposit on the eyes, like if there is a smoke and your eyes bother you, the aerosols can deposit in the eye. But especially the most important is you're breathing them in. At the beginning of the pandemic, WHO told us it's the projectiles and the smoke, the aerosols, that they call it misinformation. Now we know it's the opposite. That was a big mistake. It's really aerosols are the only important mode of transmission. This, we breathe the virus in. And WHO has accepted it if you go to the webpage, but many governments, not just the Philippines, I mean, the Netherlands, Sweden, Mexico, the US, many governments and many regional governments are behind and they haven't adapted the protocols and they keep wasting time and money on disinfecting surfaces or face shields or things that don't work.
Speaking of disinfecting surfaces, would you go as far as saying that the most common spread of infection occurs via airborne transmission? Because you've since tweeted that there are zero proven cases of hand transmission, making it a very unlikely cause.
Yeah, again, at the beginning of the pandemic, they told us that it was very easy to transmit through surfaces. And for example, myself, we were disinfecting everything. Mm-hmm. But there are many, many cases that have been investigated by scientists. Many of them have cameras and they see what people did. They haven't managed to catch a single one that's transmitted through surfaces. And the CDC now tells us, if you touch a surface that has the virus, you have a chance in 10,000 of infecting yourself. So surface transmission is not impossible, but is not what we should focus on. Airborne transmission, breathing the virus in, is the only important form of transmission. We should put there 100% of our efforts. We should wash our hands, not so much for this virus, but because there are other diseases that, that go through the hands. But then we should focus on not breathing the virus in. That's the only important thing to do.
Concerning aerosol sprays like Lysol, disinfecting sprays, do these work on disinfecting the air around us?
No, and that is dangerous. I mean, if the virus is in the air, you should wear a mask so that you don't breathe it in. But then there is three things you can do. You can take the air that has the virus floating and put it outside. That's what we call ventilation. You open the windows. The second thing you can do if you cannot do ventilation is you keep the air, but you remove the virus. So you have a filter that has a fan. So just like your mask is a filter and your lungs and your diaphragm moves the air through that filter and the virus stays in the filter, you can have a commercial HEPA filter or you can build one with a fan, and those work very well. Then the third thing you can do is you keep the air in the room and you keep the virus floating in the air, but you try to kill the virus. That's what we call disinfection, right? And that you can do ultraviolet light. It's more expensive, but it works. But then everything else, the scientists will strongly recommend against it. Putting chemicals in the air, people are putting bleach, basically, or Lysol, electronic air cleaners with ions, plasmas, photocatalysis, hydroxyls, and they're being sold like they're the new thing. All of that is dangerous. Those are chemicals. I'm a professor of chemistry. Those things produce chemicals that react with the molecules of the virus. The virus is made of proteins, nucleic acids, and lipids. If we are in that room and we breathe that air in, we are made of lipids, nucleic acids, and proteins. Whatever hurts the virus in the air is going to hurt us. So we shouldn't do disinfection except perhaps UV.
Very enlightening. What are the most common misconceptions about the health and safety protocols concerning COVID, about its transmission, how long the virus survives, and the like?
I mean, I think and a lot of this is the fault of WHO not communicating clearly. At the beginning, when we were already scared and we were all paying attention, they told us, we are certain it doesn't go through the air, it's not like a smoke, it's on the surfaces, and it's these droplets that fall. And then, you know, they have never said very strongly otherwise. So people are still confused. A lot of it goes back to that, when you were talking about the face shields or the plastic barriers, is because people are still thinking of these droplets that fall to the ground. Or if we are disinfecting, in some countries, they're disinfecting the feet and washing their hands a lot, and that is because they are thinking about the surfaces. So the biggest misconception is simply not understanding that the only important mode of transmission is breathing the virus in. The most effective measure of any measure we can do is do things outdoors. The chance of getting infected outdoors is 20 times less than indoors. So you can be at work and you can be working on the computer, but if you have to talk with your coworker, you have to have a meeting, go outside, and then you can come back in and be quiet, you know, because when you talk is when you put much more virus in the air, you know. And going outdoors is free. You know, it's not like because the virus is in the air, it's very difficult to control. And one other thing, if I can say, sometimes people hear the virus is in the air and they imagine it's like, oh, it's going to come from 5 kilometers away and it's going to go under the door. It's not like that. It's in the air, but it's especially when you talk to someone and you're very close, because that air that they are exhaling, you are breathing it in, or when you are in a box, which is a room that is trapping the air, or a jeepney or something like that. It's not it's not something phantasmagorical that the air is going to come from China and it's going to infect someone.
Yeah. And Dr. Jose, what a protective covering. Which ones would you say works best? Which kinds of masks? Which places are the most dangerous to visit outdoors amid the Omicron variant scare?
Well, so for the masks, we know for an airborne virus, and this is known for a long time, you need basically an N95 mask, or there are better masks that maybe for hospitals, but an N95 mask works well. Now, the problem that you see very often is people wear one of these masks and they have gaps. They don't adjust them to the face. Now, if you have a mask that has a certain size and you have a gap, maybe a small gap here in the nose, that's 1% of the area of the mask. That's very small. The experiments see that half of the air we breathe goes through the hole, because it's much easier for the air to go through the hole than to pass through the cloth of the mask. So we have to all pay a lot of attention to how well the mask fit. And if we have several masks, which one is the one that fits me better? Because we all have different faces. And I spend time with our friends or our husband, our wife. It's like, can you make sure I don't have any gaps? You know, and learn about that. That's something that has not been explained. Now, about which places are more or less dangerous. What increases transmission is when we increase the time that we share the air with other people in indoor spaces that are not ventilated, and especially we are talking loudly. There is many cases in which many people get infected in choirs. They are singing very loud, and then 30, 50 people get infected. But there is zero cases that I know in a library where people are quiet, or in a movie theater. You know, so the situations when we're talking loudly are the most dangerous. So for example, if you're going to go to a bar or a restaurant, they should not have music, so that, because if you have the loud music, then people have to talk more loudly and they put much more virus in the air.
Right. And what are we to do if we couldn't afford expensive and effective face masks? You know, going to back to that topic, air filters, ventilation systems. Do you think the government should try to provide these?
I mean, I think in many places, I don't know what the weather is there right now, but in many places you can open the windows during some of the time. Mm-hmm. And there is a way to know whether you are opening the windows enough, which is with CO2 meters like this one. They tell you how much exhaled air there is in the air, and we have donated some even to the Philippines and other countries. For the masks, I mean, these N95 masks, you can wear them for a week, and here they cost about $1 or 50 cents. So, I mean, it for some people, it may be too much. And then the government, I think, should provide them, because they are very effective and they are much cheaper than the economic losses of the pandemic. At the end, if when the pandemic is there, then there is a lot of economic problems, and it will be easier to provide the masks. But it is very, very important to teach people that they need to be well fit to the face. For example, my mother-in-law, who's actually from the Philippines but lives here with us, she was trying different masks, and I was helping her, and she was saying, oh, this is the best, this one I breathe the best. And I look at it, it was the best because she had huge gaps. So then it was very easy to breathe. The mask was not working. The air wasn't going through the mask, but she was very happy because she didn't know.
It defeats the purpose.
Precisely. But you see many people, and I think here in the US, you start to see more of these N95 masks, but I think at least 2/3 of the people, you see them with gaps, and then it's not so useful.
And concerning face mask care, how do we disinfect these reusable masks?
So Sometimes.
I think we lost Dr. Jose. I'll try to get him back later on, but all right, Dr. Jose, are you still there? I think we lost connection a while ago. All right. Concerning a proper care of our face masks, how do we disinfect these reusable ones?
Okay. So I was saying that the virus doesn't survive very long. So even if it is in the mask, it's going to lose infectivity naturally. I would say, I mean, what I do is I remove the mask and I wash my hands, and that's it. If I work in a hospital, I would, you know, use maybe one every day, or if I have to reuse them, what people do is put them in a paper bag, and they have one for Mondays, one for Tuesdays, one for Wednesdays, and they, you know, and by the time it's the next Monday, that any virus that was in the mask from last Monday is dead.
You can do it like smart. That. Yeah. And what's the right setup then for classrooms, public transport, restaurants, and the like? Concerning ventilation, do you think fans on the ceiling actually count, or they don't?
Well, ventilation means the air that's inside goes outside, and we get air from outside with the virus. A fan or some of the air conditioning units in the window does mix the air and move the air, but it's not ventilation in the sense of the virus. The virus is still in the room.
Yeah, so it doesn't go out.
Mm-hmm. Fans work. What some people do is put a fan in the window, either pointing out so that the air with the virus goes outside, or to bring fresh air in, or that kind of thing. I mean, the fans or mixing the air, you know, doesn't matter a lot. You can imagine that there is a smoke floating in there. It's going to mix it faster. But if you spend a lot of time in that room, the smoke is going to mix anyway, so it's not very important. What's important is to think how I can get the air that's there and continuously ventilate. Also, something about ventilation that people get very confused is that they think, so for example, in Spain, where I'm from, they said, okay, we're going to open the classrooms before the children arrive, and then the children are there with the windows closed, and then we open the windows when the children have left. That makes no sense. If the virus is coming out one of the children or the teacher, you want the windows open all the time when they are there, and then you can close them when they are not there. And for example, in Spain, it was cold, and other places is hot. And what they found is they could open three windows, you know, 15 centimeters, and that was enough. You know, that creates enough. So you don't need to feel like a wind inside the room. That's too much ventilation. But you need to have the windows open a little bit so that lets the air go through. And together with the masks, with good masks, that helps a lot.
Most important is airflow outside. All right. So, and are you thinking of reaching out and perhaps bringing this research of yours to the country's epidemiologists to help us?
I'll be glad to. I have given already a couple of seminars organized by some private organizations in the Philippines. In one of them, someone from the Department of Health attended. And I'm happy to talk to anyone who contacts me. And I have talked to many, many, many governments, from ministers and from many countries that I cannot disclose. But and the problem is that they often don't listen. You know, that's why sometimes I have to resort to Twitter. You know, after 2 years, I mean, we have known for 2 years that the virus transmit this way, and yet people keep wasting time on these face shields and these plexiglass barriers. So that's why one of the things I've been doing on Twitter is saying, you know, these are countries that are doing things well, and these are countries that are doing things poorly. Very often it's the same country. So in the US, there are people who are doing things well in some places, and there are people who are doing things very poorly, and the same in the UK, and the same in Germany, and imagine the same in the Philippines.
Lastly, speaking of Twitter and social media, do you think it's still the best way to spread awareness to everyone concerning COVID? You know, facts about it, and
I find it very useful. I am of a certain age, and I didn't use Twitter before the pandemic. I found it very confusing. But at the beginning of the pandemic here, President Trump really didn't let the scientists in the government talk. So all the scientists went to Twitter and started talking to each other and talking to the public. And it has really become the place where when there is a new study, normally the scientist explains the study in Twitter, and then you can ask questions and you know, about the vaccine, about the Omicron, about the air. So I do find it very useful. It's, you know, it takes a little bit getting used to, especially for older people, but I think it is worth it.
Right. Thank you so much for a very enlightening discussion with us. Dr. Jose, you stay safe.
Thank you for having me.